saw that freed from apartheid, the people have good reason to celebrate. But this new freedom is threatened by the escalating AIDS problem. More than 4.5 million South Africans are infected with HIV, now less than a quarter of the population. South Africa is at the top of the world list of countries struck by AIDS. This is Bongiwe and her daughter Busi. Bongiwe is 26. She lives in Kalicha, one of the townships around Cape Town. When she was expecting Busi, she found out that she was HIV positive.
Since I heard this news that I am positive, I decided to leave everything because I had no hope that what is the use of being a student or studying for a degree while I'm going to die.
Just like Bongiwe, she's 26 and HIV positive.
Maybe in 5 years or 2 years to come, you won't be talking to Mofundo again. There will be no Mofundo, you see. So, those are the things that I always sometimes think, but I don't want to frustrate myself and think a lot about them because the stress, I'll be stressing myself, and the stress is the first enemy of the virus, you see.
Sleeping sickness is not easy to diagnose. It requires a number of tests to identify the parasite.
Don't worry, it's not painful. I'll just go slow, okay? It's not painful, okay?
And the tests establish proof. William is infected with sleeping sickness even at a far advanced stage. Patients who do not get a timely treatment slip into a coma and inevitably die. William and his father go back home to pick up his things. He'll return to the hospital to undergo 3 weeks' treatment, a treatment with an archaic drug that is not without its risks. Bongiwe used to live in Durban. When she found out that she was pregnant, she and her boyfriend had a fight. Afraid to tell her family that she was HIV positive, Bongiwe fled to Cape Town and moved in with her sister. She's lost contact with her daughter's father, who doesn't know that Bongiwe is infected. Her sister doesn't know either. That's why we interview Bongiwe outside the house.
He doesn't know anything about his child, and I also hate him because I believe he's the one who infected me. So I really hate him. I hate him. Before I had sexual intercourse with him, I told him for several times to go for an HIV test, and he always refused. Why was he refusing if he didn't tell me anything? It's because he knew that he already infected, but he wanted to infect me so that he can die alone. That's what they always say, that I can die alone. What worries me is that as he is in heaven, he still has other relationships and he keeps on infecting the other people.
Besides being a threat to public health, AIDS also has an enormous impact on the economy and development of a country, tearing families apart. Parents fall ill, unable to carry on with their jobs. 10 years ago, less than 1% of the population in Goemaere township was HIV positive. Today, more than 20% are infected. Goemaere, a doctor who works in this township, looks upon the situation with sorrow. The treatment of patients with AIDS is very frustrating.
Alors nous les soignons uniquement pour ce qu'on appelle les maladies opportunistiques, c'est-à-dire
opportunistic diseases,
des maladies
fungi diseases, tuberculosis,
ou la tuberculose qui est extrêmement
importante.
Ce genre de maladies qui n'apparaissent pas
sur le statut
contribuent à déprimer.
Et donc, les soins pour ces maladies,
mais il faudrait évidemment faire plus, c'est-à-dire leur donner ce qu'on donne en Europe, dans les pays riches, la triple thérapie des antirétroviraux.
Par exemple, l'antirétroviraux,
c'est un problème de coût. Alors, nous, en tant que médecins, évidemment, c'est totalement inacceptable de savoir et de voir donc nos patients qui se dégradent. Même si vous soignez les maladies opportunistes, vous les voyez évoluer, se dégrader et mourir à petit feu, que vous savez qu'il y a un traitement qui existe.
Most of the HIV patients in the poor countries can't afford them, as they cost $10,000 per patient every year. Generic or brand-free versions of the drugs are up to 100 times cheaper. The pharmaceutical companies intend to cut out these competitors, using their patent right to prevent the access to cheap generic drugs.
There has to be a realistic expectation of where these industries' duties begin and where they end. Also a realistic expectation of where government responsibilities begin and where they end as well. But certainly we are very aware of the fact that there is enormous suffering in the developing world. We are very aware of the fact that traditionally the market principles that we rely on for supply and demand will appear in some instances not to work for the developing world diseases. But that is not because there is a fault in the market system. It is a fault of the broader economic ills of the developing countries. It is arguable that for some developing countries, no price will be affordable for HIV, or no price might be affordable for any disease whatsoever. When you consider that some of those countries only spend $10 a year per patient on healthcare.
On their way home, William and his father are accompanied by Martin, a sleeping sickness assistant at the hospital. William's family lives 25 kilometers away in a refugee camp. They arrived a few months ago after having fled from famine-stricken Sudan. It is these migrations, caused by war and famine, that have contributed to the resurgence of the disease over the past 20 years. William has all the symptoms of sleeping sickness. He's tired and extremely weak, and suffers from sleep disorders, headaches, and fever.
I'm tired. I'm suffering. My body is tired. I'm not even able to walk.
As after that, he is positive. And now I'm working in stage 2 of the disease, which is the latest stage. So here I'm currently delivering him while taking for treatment because of my career is going to worsen his life. That's why I've come to pick the tender, because the father is going to attend the child himself. The father will be the attendant. He will care for William, do the cooking and laundry during the 22 days of the treatment. Having collected some clothes and cooking gear, it's time to make the 25-kilometer journey back to the hospital. The world-famous Institute for Tropical Medicine in Antwerp, Belgium, is a suitable spot to meet with Dr. Giorgio Rossigno. He used to work for the pharmaceutical industry for 20 years and knows it like the back of his hand. Today, he leads an organization that seeks to develop new drugs against tuberculosis. He also belongs to an international group of specialists engaged in finding better drugs for neglected diseases.
The pharmaceutical industry has a strong interest in unmet medical needs that can create, let's say, massive profits for the pharmaceutical industry. And if you look at the research program years, and a very small amount, if at all, goes for diseases like sleeping sickness or leishmania. That is certainly true, but this is because of the nature of the pharmaceutical industry that is accountable to shareholders that want to see profit at the end of the year. And to see the pharmaceutical industry embarking in very expensive exercise of developing drugs for neglected diseases might not be perceived as the right message for the shareholders of that specific company.
In South Africa alone, AIDS kills 250,000 people every year. Last year, President Mbeki declared that there was no connection between HIV and AIDS, but AIDS was caused by poverty, a statement which shocked the world.
If people think that if you're HIV positive, then it means that you are not going to die of AIDS, you see, as Mr. Maggie said. You see, I think Mr. Maggie needs to come back and tell the people the right thing. While the top leadership in our country questioned, in fact, whether HIV causes AIDS. Now, if you start with that problematic precept, you can't even get to the negotiating table about how you put together a partnership that benefits everybody. If HIV doesn't cause AIDS, then why do you need our medicines? Because I can tell you one thing. But internationally, our scientists and our products are based on the fact that, in fact, HIV does cause AIDS. So you see the gulf of the problem.
In order to prevent mother-to-child transmission of the virus, a pregnant woman can use AZT, which particularly for developing countries is an extremely expensive drug. The Guyliche Hospital runs a free AZT distribution program. At first, Mongiwe would have nothing to do with it.
I didn't want to take AZT because I wanted, I knew that I am HIV positive and definitely I knew that there is no cure or treatment for it. And I was aware that I am going to die. As I heard that information that I am going to die, I didn't want to die alone and leaving my child orphaned. I wanted her also to die so that I won't leave anything in the world.
But then you took AZT.
And then I decided to take it. And now I'm so grateful because my child is negative and I can only think of giving her up for adoption after I'm getting very ill.
As a sleeping sickness assistant, Martin is on the road every day searching for infected people. But first he takes us to the river, which is the focal point of sleeping sickness in the region.
This is a source of river where most children come and take bath. And women also, they come and fetch water here for either cooking or for washing clothes. The sisterflies, as they live along the riverbanks, when they see these women and the children, they come and bite them. And if that sisterfly who bites the third group of people is infected one, then he injects the disease in them. That's why you find most of the communities here, they have the disease.
The tsetsefly transmits the parasite that causes sleeping sickness. The number of infected people in Africa today is estimated at 500,000. These people should be traced and treated as soon as possible, since they are the ones who carry the parasite that may be further transmitted by the tsetsefly.
So see, because it is necessary to give information for the community, because most of them think sleeping sickness is spread when you eat pork and when you sexually stay with your partner, and witchcraft can also give the disease. So we give the information for them, and we also fill the notes if the notes are supposed to send them to the hospital to be tested against sleeping sickness.
Swollen lymph nodes are one of the first symptoms of sleeping sickness. Once diagnosis is confirmed, treatment can start. There is, however, only one drug available for sleeping sickness, which goes back to the 1940s. It's toxic, and it's increasingly ineffective.
Sleeping sickness is quite an important disease in Africa. still it affects a relatively small number of people. We're talking about maybe 500,000 people per year. And this obviously does not represent any return on investment for any pharmaceutical industry.
I'm from Treatment Action Campaign. We are giving education to students, to pupils, to everybody, to teachers also, about HIV and AIDS, prevention and awareness, and treatment. But you know anything about HIV and AIDS, you can tell me. Anything that you know about HIV and AIDS.
Treatment Action Campaign, or TAC, is a South African organization of HIV and AIDS patients that defends the right to affordable medicines. Uwe and Mofundo are two of the most militant TAC members.
AIDS is very dangerous, Woody. What can you say? AIDS has killed many people. Is he lying?
No. Today is the first time Uwe speaks in public about her status.
I gave birth to a healthy baby. My child is now 1 year, 7 months, and she is negative while I'm positive. But I'm not comfortable with that because I know that at some stage I might die. So who's going to take responsibility of her after my death? So that's what is worrying me. So it's not really nice to be HIV positive. So don't take responsibility of yourselves. That's my message to you.
It was okay, it wasn't difficult, even though it was my first time to disclose in public, because I used to disclose in the support groups. So it was really my first time, and I didn't get any problems. I did enjoy it, so I think I'll keep on disclosing. It's not difficult to disclose. And I think that I'm strong enough now again, face the public and their questions also.
In Omugo, the medical team is about to make their daily rounds at the hospital.
Reverend, how are you? You're doing well?
I'm doing well.
That's good.
Yes, sir.
William has spent his first night in the hospital. Now it will be decided when his treatment is going to start. Olema, the head of the medical team, is not a doctor, but a sleeping sickness coordinator. Olema's many years' experience has made him the sleeping sickness specialist for the whole region.
This one, we admitted him yesterday. It's stage two. And if you can see this boy, William, he is quite weak. He does not talk very clearly. He walks with the support. His feeding is also assisted. And I think the treatment he's going to get is Myosopro, which is also very toxic. And that there's something wrong with the drug, he may react. He may have a reaction side effect to the drug. We really need to take a lot of precautions. But there's no way we can help him other than giving the drug like this toxic, because that's the only option we have.
For 60 years already, Myosopro has been the only available drug. There are two possible alternative drugs, but these are either virtually impossible to get or have never been effectively tested. In view of the apparent general lack of interest in sleeping sickness, in Omugo, they started looking for more appropriate treatment themselves, combining the three drugs.
And breathing stop. The patients that we are putting on the trial, they must always fulfill, they must not be lost to follow. And the boy is a refugee. Every time he may feel going back to Sudan, we may not end up his control successfully. So he may be lost to follow. So for these reasons, we're not including him at the moment. So we just have to predispose him to a toxic drug like that. But of course, keep our fingers crossed that nothing really happens to him. Because there's no option. We will wish him the best.
Context of the north, making it a property, I guess, certain discovery of Alzheimer's three diseases that were otherwise untreatable. Now, when you try to apply this intellectual property right to developing countries, that's where you find these clashes. So, I am not sure that it is because of that law that the pharmaceutical industry do not invest in research for neglected diseases. I think that that doesn't happen mainly because there is no profit in developing those drugs, and there is a need for industry to take a social responsibility to develop these drugs for neglected diseases.
More than 500 antiretroviral experiments are said to be carried out in South Africa today, turning the country into the pharmaceutical industry's playground. After having been tested in South Africa, the new drugs are sold at a high price, be it hardly ever within the country itself, because the great majority of the population cannot afford to buy them. Talk about a paradox. And that is not quite the whole story.
The Medicines Control Council is making allegations that we don't observe standards, we're treating people as guinea pigs, and when the trial stops, that they don't have the medication for life. And that is simply not true. We abide by something called the Helsinki Declaration in the conduct of clinical trials. And those guidelines are very strict and stringent. And certainly the members who belong to the PMA have to abide by those. If we have a hint that they are not observing Helsinki Declaration, they will not be members of the PMA.
Goemaere is a volunteer in one of those clinical trials. She's being administered antiretrovirals.
I'm lucky because I was chosen to go under those clinical trials, and as I've already said, that I started in late 1999 after giving birth to my child, and I was told that clinical trials will last only for 2 years. But I'm still under those trials, and they already told me that if I become resistant to it, they will change it to another one.
It's here in this medical center that Goemaere gets her treatment. The question is whether she'll get any further treatment after the experiment. Not only does the Helsinki Declaration remain vague on the subject, nobody in the medical center wanted to speak to us.
L'exemple de Goemaere,
is the most unbearable example of the cynicism of this situation.
Goemaere
does not have a choice.
Elle she knows that she's going to die shortly. Elle a envie parce
she's barely 20 years old.
Elle a à peine un peu plus
and she
de
wants
temps.
To survive. Therefore, she will seize any opportunity.
Nous référons régulièrement
we regularly send vers ces essais thérapeutiques to these therapeutic experiments
comme on dit, c'est mieux
because
que
we say it is better than nothing.
Effectivement droit à un
she will indeed have a right to a treatment that will make her survive for another two,
ans,
maybe 3 years.
I don't think they will stop the treatment, but they said they will give me another treatment so that I don't develop resistance to this one I'm taking. So they didn't say that they will stop it completely.
Les règles disent
the rule with treatment is that as long as the treatment is effective, we will do it.
Mais après un certain
but after all, when her body will not react correctly anymore, she won't be offered anything else instead. She'll be removed from the therapeutic experiment. And at that moment, they will leave her to fend for herself.
Elle commence à ce moment-là à acheter ses médicaments et donc ce sera la fin.
There is a need for new drugs against sleeping sickness. The development of such a drug requires research and investments by the pharmaceutical industry. But since a market of patients who cannot afford the drugs is not lucrative, hardly any research is done.
If this disease was in Europe, by now it could have been a disease under control. Could have been a disease under control. Once you get it and you are treated, just outright, without much problems, there would have been so much concern. But because it is an African problem, I think there's that problem of not really exposing it further to the European world for concern.
The tech activists are preparing for a large demonstration in Pretoria where an important court case is about to start. 39 pharmaceutical companies have filed a complaint against
is HIV and AIDS because they cannot afford the prices of the treatment because they are so high. So we really don't like what is happening here in South Africa because each and every day people are dying because of this HIV and AIDS thing. So we are fighting for the drug companies to reduce their prices.
That's a sad symbol, no?
Yeah, it is a sad symbol. We are also sad. I know that one day it will be me. It won't be like these names here. It will be my name. So that's why I'm so worried. And keep on fighting for these drugs to be affordable.
The fact that so quickly drugs have been developed to treat HIV has very much to do with the fact that most of the patients at the beginning of the world epidemic were discovered in the north, in the United States and Europe. So certainly the fact that we are now facing these concomitant epidemics in the north and the south that can be treated with the same drugs that are, let's say, protected by intellectual property right in the north, and the fact that these drugs are not available in the south is certainly the first very big crisis in international health. It never happened before because the disease prevalent in the north were not those, the disease prevalent in the south. So this combination, this coincidence of these two epidemics and the fact that the tools available are not the one discovered in the north is creating this this inequality, and this certainly has to be corrected.
Victoria Supreme Court, the stars of the court case, pharmaceutical industry versus the South African government, attracts a great deal of attention.
I think this is probably one of the most important delays in our history, because the outcome of this case will decide whether we get access to medicines or not. It will also place a responsibility, a constitutional responsibility, on our government to provide access to medicines for all people in South Africa, and in particular people with HIV and AIDS.
The main issue of the court case is a law allowing the importation and manufacturing of affordable drugs. According to the pharmaceutical companies, this law is a violation of their patent right and of the World Trade Organization's regulations. The lawsuit has blocked the law's application for 4 years now.
We're going to court not to stop access to HIV medicine. We're going there to ensure that the rule of law is observed, that in fact access takes place through constitutional means in an orderly fashion. Because if it doesn't, then it makes our ability to actually help in future or to partner and supply good quality medicines almost impossible. And South Africa has more to lose from an exit of the pharmaceutical companies. And people, investors, are very wary of a country which doesn't respect the rule of law.
If we had been able to trust this law, I'm not sure we would be in a position to do it for our people. That is why this act is so important for us.
This is not about access to medicine. The government has everything it claims it needs in existing law. All that's missing, really, is political will and political commitment.
We had begun on this particular issue together with many organizations in South Africa. We're working together because it's important for us as we challenge some of these major decisions that we do, these things together. And as I say, indeed, one wishes the act, the pharmaceutical companies, have not taken the course that they've taken, because I am sure by now, perhaps more South African lives would have been saved.
Drug companies are really abusing their patents. They want us to die. Though they have the drugs, but they don't want to give us the drugs. They don't want to lower the prices. So we are supporting our government today.
The
is important. We'll succeed someday. There's no doubt in my mind, because we've got right on our side. There's not a single major civil society body who has defended the right of the pharmaceutical companies to profiteer from people's lives. And so for us, in the end, this case is just about as very simple as it. It's about life or greed. Nothing else, life or greed.
Misoprostol contains arsenic. It can have serious side effects and sometimes leads to death. What it boils down to is that the patient first has to survive the drug. Misoprostol injection is a painful experience and its side effects can be life-threatening. What's more, the drug doesn't guarantee the patient's recovery.
The problem we see with most of these patients is once we treat them like this and they go home, they're still very, very sick and they lose interest to come back to us because they know we don't have any option, any option to help them any better apart from them being their own. And dying there. There's no choice for them. 50% of all stage 2 cases are resistant to the drug we're administering. So we're losing a lot of people despite administering this drug.
On the first day of the trial, the court session was adjourned. On being asked to provide evidence on why their drug prices are so high, the pharmaceutical companies request more time to collect the information required.
I think there are a lot of people here, even a few thousand. I can't tell. But I think it's a success. If anything, this proves that the street is out here to defend its rights. A lot of people here are HIV positive. They've come here to defend their rights and to demand a treatment facing the courthouse. Very symbolic. And they demand a treatment to be able to survive. They demand to survive. But they've been stopped because of their rights are being placed second to profits. Look, this says it all. Lives before profits. I think this summarizes everything.
6 weeks later, just before the reopening of the trial, the pharmaceutical industry drops the case. In return, the government promises to consult the industry on the introduction in South Africa of affordable drugs and to respect the World Trade Organization's regulations. End of the case, and a victory for the government, the AIDS activists, and the patients.
The same time is only the first part of a very long war, and this war will now turn into a anything